Okay, we love our technical difficulties. That's part of the fun, Phil. We do it every time. So,
yeah.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to our show on health and livelihood. Today's show, we have joining us Stuart Hart from the Enterprise for a Sustainable World. We'll talk about Stu for a second because he's sort of one of the living legends in this world of base of the pyramid innovation and everything else. We've got Philip Kotler, the father of modern marketing. We've got Bob Freling from the Solar Electric Light Fund in DC. Hennie Botes from South Africa, the founder and inventor of Moladi Formworks, which is a very innovative sort of affordable housing technique and company. And Mo Kasti from the Physician Leadership Institute in Tampa, Florida. So we've got a full house here. And then, of course, we've got members of our Wicked7 working group who are helping put this together. So we'll start. Let's see, where should we start? Since it's health and livelihood, maybe we'll start with Mo for a second. Since Mo is sitting in the car waiting to rush off to the hospital.
Mm-hmm.
Mo, you got to get yourself off mute, but why is it that the U.S. has sort of the highest healthcare costs in the world? And let's just compare ourselves to Canada for a second. We spend something like $13,000 per year per person. Canada spends something like half that. And they live about 4 years longer in Canada than we do in the US. And it's colder in Canada, so they shouldn't be living longer. They should be freezing. So what's going on, Mo? Why is the US healthcare system tragically inadequate? What's going on?
Well, tragically inadequate is a relative term because it depends. If you have insurance in the United States, then it's not inadequate. It's perfectly fine because right, somebody else is paying the bill. But you kind of have to look at it on a global level. But historically, how we got here is healthcare system in the United States started as a charity activity. It used to be that the church or, you know, that they will start as part of helping their community, they will start a hospital and or they will start providing care as an extension of that. So it evolved over time to be supposedly non-for-profit charitable, and many of the organizations today still enjoy that benefit of the non-for-profit. And in healthcare in the US, the society didn't come to it from a perspective that this is healthcare is a right. We looked at it as healthcare as a service. And since it's being provided by a charitable organization, so everybody's taken care of. And as things evolved, we created this new concept called insurance. And as the costs have gone up, then insurance became the way of being able to cover the cost, but everybody is undercovered. And so if you compare it to Canada, Canada considers healthcare to be a right and is socially provided as part of your social benefit. In the US, we provided it more as a benefit of employment. And if you look at it again from a macro level, everybody looks at it as, when we made it a benefit of employment, I think that's when we went wrong in that case. And so that it became something that if you're not employed, you don't get it type of aspect. And everybody's scared not to have insurance. And every time we try to correct it, everybody talks about you're socializing it or the government is trying to take over it. But, you know, there's no one solution other than let's just make sure to expand the government coverage to all of that, because every time you try to change it, you're taking a dollar away from somebody else's revenue. And so we have a fragmented system that not everybody is on the same page of accepting that this is healthcare is a right for all of us, not a luxury that we can just live without.
Now, I have a question in terms of healthcare. We know that it was, I think, Richard Nixon who made it a for-profit thing, right? Is that correct? That before that, it was not a for, it was not a, it was just a, that healthcare became a for-profit business when Richard Nixon signed into law a bill that basically said that you can now make profits off healthcare. And I think since then it's sort of accelerated. And of course, as you mentioned, the insurance industry. So the question then is, what do people need to do to, what do we need to do to stop this madness? And it's become politicized, as you say, people say, hey, if you want healthcare, you're a socialist. And yet, we're sort of the only rich country that doesn't have healthcare and for all. Let's put it, we do have healthcare, but for a few. And as unemployment goes up, the question then is, what did COVID do to healthcare in this country? Just a few minutes on that, and then we'll move on. Yeah.
Look, I think it's the issue for us in healthcare is that it's our healthcare system is inefficient and expensive. And so always the discussion comes back to is who's going to pay for it. And so if we really want to make healthcare available to everyone, we have to reduce the cost of it. And that's the starting point. And whether it is for profit or non-for-profit, it's everybody makes profit, even if they're called non-for-profit. It's just that it's damn expensive. It's inefficient. 30 to 50% of it is unnecessary, redundant. And so we have the most expensive healthcare system in the world, and COVID have exposed that. COVID has clearly exposed that we were not prepared for a pandemic where we couldn't even find who has a ventilator, an extra ventilator in a hospital. Right? Every hospital knows how many ventilators they have, but we don't have a unified system that says who has ventilators, who has extra need, lower need. So clearly COVID has changed the game of saying we need to truly look at, do we have a preventative health system or do we have an expensive healthcare? And I think the starting point is we just need to simplify it and reduce the cost of it. And we're not even close to that.
Yeah, and there's certainly no consensus that even needs to happen. So that's wicked problem number one right there. the fact that we can't even get our health. And then of course, let's go global and say, there was the UN Secretary General who's from Portugal was saying that in Portugal, 80% of the people are vaccinated. And in some countries in the world, let's say, maybe not in the developing world, some of these countries have 2% vaccine rates. And so this kind of vaccine apartheid that's happening is sort of very dangerous because as long as the virus exists in populations that haven't been vaccinated, then you have the chance, of course, of it mutating further. And so this is sort of an interrelatedness thing that we really do need to find a way to have a global system that is more responsive and works across countries. And of course, Stuart, I'm going to switch to you now because we have the same problem with, we just cannot seem to work together as a world to fight poverty, to find solutions to things at the challenges at the bottom of the pyramid. Now, I'm going to go back and talk about Stuart for a second. Stuart Hart wrote the first article, The Fortune at the Bottom of the Pyramid, with C.K. Prahlad all those years ago, which got turned into a book by C.K. But Stu, what's changed since when you wrote that book? Let's go back for a minute here.
Tragically, not nearly enough has changed. But I would say probably if I look at it, kind of the big view, demographically, the biggest change is the world is no longer shaped like a pyramid. So, the title of that article 20 years ago the fortune at the bottom of the pyramid. You know, each piece of it has been deconstructed, but there it was undeniable that 20 years ago, demographically, the world was shaped like a pyramid. But what's happened over the last 20 years, which is a good news, bad news story, at least in part, is that, you know, for a variety of reasons, probably the main one being China's explosion, you know, economic explosion, is that, you know, hundreds of millions of people have been lifted out of, you know, extreme poverty as measured by income, you know, income poverty, they've been lifted out of income poverty. So that increasingly the world looks more like a bottom-heavy diamond. It's no longer a pyramid. Whereas 20 years ago, there were, you know, 4.5 billion people at the base of the income pyramid. Now, you know, it's bulgier toward the middle, right? Where we now have, you know, going on 4 billion people that have, that are in the rising middle classes. Yeah, exactly. It's beginning to look more like a diamond. And as incomes go up, so does consumption. But that still leaves, you know, there are still in excess of 3 billion people at the base of the income pyramid. So it's not as though that issue has gone away. It's just that I think we face now even more challenges in some ways than we did 20 years ago with the climate crisis on our doorstep. And poverty is sort of the whole idea of poverty now, you have to think about inequality and poverty in the same breath, you know, that there are probably three parallel poverty problems. One of which is, you know, at the very base of the income pyramid, which is a largely developing world rural problem, mainly agricultural, right? Smallholder farmers, you know, still are still the dominant employment base in the world is smallholder farming. And as more and more people migrate and leave for cities, then it becomes increasingly problematic, you know, for smallholder farmers to actually make a go of them. So we have, you know, the challenge of the legacy base of the pyramid, which is a largely rural smallholder farming based set of communities that are being bled, you know, by mostly the young people leaving, which, you know, is sort of the problem coming from the base of the income pyramid. At the top, of course, we've had, you know, especially in the U.S., but I think it's happening all over the developed world, deindustrialization and hollowing out now for two or three, four decades in some cases, where, you know, we end up, we see it happening, playing out, you know, here in the U.S. Before our eyes, where rising inequality, you know, inequality has reached, you know, levels that had only been reached in the late 20s. And so you end up, you know, with a discontented, resentment-fueled, you know, sort of set of people falling out of the middle class. So you have kind of a growing problem of inequality and rising poverty at the top of the income pyramid, which then pressures government to cut things like international aid development and so forth, which only further fuels what's happening at the base. And then at the middle, you have, you know, this growing, you know, increasingly big bulge at the lower middle part of the diamond, which is largely urban and increasingly urban slum, shantytown, squatter community driven, where incomes are going up, but, you know, quality of life doesn't necessarily follow that. And all of the challenges that go along with rising consumption, you know, and urbanization. So, you know, I think about sitting here today, there are these sort of three interrelated parallel, quote, poverty problems, if you can frame it that way. You know, whereas maybe 20 years ago, life looked somewhat simpler. I mean, all three of these were still there. But I think the tendency among those interested in kind of sustainable development was focused more on the base of the pyramid.
So, Stu, is this in your new book? Can you tell us a little bit about that?
It is. Yeah. So I've been working, you know, the COVID year, you know, sort of afforded the opportunity to spend a lot more focused time on this. So I have a new book I'm working on, which is tentatively entitled The Next Capitalist Reformation. And it the first part of the book is more historical, right? So I look back 400 years, you know, kind of main thesis being, this isn't the first, you know, this is not the first rodeo in terms of, you know, kind of capitalist overreach. Not the first time that it's happened. It's happened at least two times before, you know, going back to the, you know, the kind of the mercantilism and the age of discovery. And then, of course, again, with industrial capitalism in the late 19th century. So I go back and try to, you know, kind of reconstruct and deconstruct that and harvest learnings, because, of course, people have had to grapple with, you know, kind of, as I say, capitalist overreach and excess before, and it's been reined in before. And so we can learn from that. So I try to harvest those learnings, but then also kind of realize that the challenges that we face today, you know, the nature of kind of capitalist overreach and exploitation, there are elements of it today that just have never been faced before. The main one, you know, we've certainly faced toxic inequality before, but we've never faced a situation where the very life support system upon which everyone depends has been threatened by capitalism. But we do now, right? So I try to kind of trace that as well, and then spend some time thinking about what are the corporate transformations, you know, that need to happen above and beyond the sustainability movement that's already been in place. But then I think, as many are growing to realize, you know, you see more and more kind of writing around this theme, that even if every corporation were to, you know, sort of become purpose-driven, you know, sustainability-oriented and so forth tomorrow, it still wouldn't be enough, because the you know, sort of surrounding contextual systems slow it down, or in many cases prevent, you know, the ability of corporations to make the kind of transformations they need to make. So it becomes increasingly important for, you know, the corporate world itself to become involved in system redesign. So the third part of the book focuses on that, you know, and I have a chapter on reinvention of business education, because for my money, one of the biggest root causes of the problem that we face is business education, at least as it's been conceived for the last 30 plus years. It must be creatively destroyed, because I think it is one of the root causes. But then, of course, the larger sort of policy context and so forth, and just the very way in which the financial infrastructure has been defined over the last 30 or 40 years has to absolutely be systemically changed. Right? So those two things are interrelated, right? We've trained a bunch of MBAs that have been brainwashed into shareholder primacy and market fundamentalism and so forth. They then land in financial jobs, and they construct, you know, it's a set of social constructions, you know, that say that shareholder primacy should be the rule of the land, and that, you know, short-term profitability and quarterly earnings should drive value. So I think we're in the midst of one of those transformations where we're in a process of redefining the very concept of what value means, or we must redefine the very concept of what value means. We're in the thick of that right now, and that means, you know, sort of fundamental institutional redesign and system redesign.
And what if we don't go fast enough, Stu? Should we be in the streets?
Well, I mean, I think we crossed the Rubicon a while ago. Yeah. So, you know, that increasingly now, I think that becomes widely seen by virtually everyone.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, on that cheery note, we'll turn to Bob and Hennie. But stay tuned. Don't run away, Stu. We want to come back and ask you some more questions. So Bob Freling was the subject, and the Solar Electric Light Fund was the subject of an article, Stuart, that you wrote a while back with Clayton Christensen, the late, great Clayton Christensen. Yeah. So Bob, why don't you tell us a little bit about that article? And then, of course, tell us a little bit about what you're doing. But I just wanted to connect the two of you. Yeah,
I'll actually defer to Stu because I think he's and you are probably better versed with his thinking and how it relates to what the work I do. But basically, it was the idea of reverse innovation, and the idea that many of the innovative technologies and solutions that ultimately have relevance for the whole world often come from the base of the pyramid. In our case, we deal with energy solutions. Because, well, we've been around for a while. When we started back in 1990, The number that was tossed about was 2 billion people in the world that don't have access to electricity. Now the number has gone down to about a billion, although I sometimes question that official statistic, because I know in many cases, the World Bank may consider a village electrified when you have one point of connection that's connected, but many of the homes are not connected. So even those official statistics that you get from the World Bank can be misleading. But however you slice the pie, a billion people is still a lot of folks. We in the developed world often take electricity for granted. Ever since I was a kid, I've been able to flip the switch and have electric light come on. And even if we travel, we go to on a safari and we go to Kenya and we go to Nairobi, there's electricity in Nairobi. There's electricity probably in the lodge that you stay at. You really have to get off the beaten path and go into the really more remote rural areas. And suddenly you find a very different world. Hennie, I've had the pleasure of working in South Africa. We electrified a school in the Valley of a Thousand Hills in KwaZulu-Natal. And I'll never forget the first time I traveled there. I was in downtown Durban, and it was like being in Southern California with, very fancy shopping centers. I mean, it was no different from being in Los Angeles. And then you get in a car and you travel for 45 minutes from downtown Durban, and you're in this extremely remote part of Africa with no electricity. And it was difficult for me to wrap my mind around that, but that's the reality. And people who grow up here, we freak out if there's a power outage. Let's say there's a hurricane or an ice storm and we can't have power for a few hours or a few days. But, imagine living your whole life without electricity, right?
Forget the internet, Bob.
No lights, no refrigeration, no computers. Pretty much everything we associate with modern civilization is made possible by this thing called electricity. And it really undermines every aspect of their existence. When we started, our focus was solar home lighting systems and using microcredit as a way of enabling rural households to pay for and take ownership in these solar home systems. And that paved the way for launching a for-profit affiliate in India called the Solar Electric Light Company, or Selco. And under the leadership of Harish Handy, Selco has gone on to do fantastic things in India.
As a for-profit, guys.
As a for-profit, that's right. And then later, at the beginning in the year 2000, I started to think about, well, lighting at the household level is very important. I've been blessed with the opportunity to see many families flip that electric switch and come on for the first time. I know how transformative it can be for children to be able to read and study at night, to no longer have to breathe in kerosene fumes, and to be able to extend your productive day into the evening hours. So just bringing light into a home is game changing. But I thought, well, why should we just stop with household lighting when photovoltaics, which is the technology we've primarily been working with, can be used to address needs at the community level. So very deliberately, we sort of expanded our mandate and started to explore a larger universe of applications that we could bring to rural communities and use the solar power beyond just household lighting purposes to bring about improvements for health, education, and economic development. So we started to do schools. I mentioned KwaZulu-Natal. We put in place, I believe it was the first solar-powered computer lab at a rural school in South Africa. And it was very exciting to go and see these kids be able to log onto their computers and access the internet back in the year 2000. And then we started to electrify clinics and use solar energy to pump water for drinking and irrigation. And at some point it became clear that energy was really foundational, that there was a really powerful way in which we could harness sunlight to address a multiplicity of needs across the board at the village level. And so we put together what we initially called the Solar Integrated Development Model. Later, we sort of tweaked that name and called it the Whole Village Model. But essentially, the idea is to go in and use solar energy and perhaps other energy technologies as well. We like the sun because it's the most widely distributed source of energy on the planet. And of course, the cost has plummeted over the last two decades. And new technologies are coming online as we speak, new thin film technologies, perovskites, and they're also working on next generation battery solutions. So it's an exciting time to be in this field. And of course, it's mainstream now. Even our current administration has set out pretty ambitious goals for scaling solar here in this country over the next 10 to 15 years. But our focus has been primarily remote parts of the developing world that have never been connected to an electric grid. Here, a few watts don't really mean much, but there, a few watts can mean the difference between having light or no light, having clean water or no water, having healthcare, including the power to store vaccines. And this whole energy access challenge comes very much into play now. As you mentioned, Christian, we are in a race, if you will, to vaccinate the world or wait until this virus mutates to some other deadly form that even is able to evade our current vaccine. So it's critical to get vaccines out to the world. The problem is when you go to rural parts of, let's say, sub-Saharan Africa, and you don't have reliable electricity, what happens to the cold chain, right? Which means what happens to the vaccines? Vaccines need to be refrigerated. We've actually worked with a next generation vaccine refrigeration solution, solar powered, that can get the job done. So we would like to think that we have a meaningful role to play in thinking through this challenge of getting the whole world vaccinated. It's critical. Energy is, as you know, through the Wicked7 model, everything's complex and everything's related to everything else. As a carpenter who, sees everything through nails, as an energy guy, see everything through the lens of energy. And for me, energy is foundational. It addresses it, or it can address all of the sustainable development goals, not to mention, go ahead, Christian. I'm sorry. I'm just rambling here.
Yeah, I'm going to shut you up for a second, Bob, because you actually gave me an entryway into Hennie, which is in your integrated solar development model for the village, where you're doing everything, from drip irrigation to raising the crops to selling the crops to powering the clinic to the school. The thing that's left out is housing. So I want to add Hennie's housing to your solar village, and then we'll have a more holistic village. So Hennie, tell us your story. And it's been a while now, but when I first met Hennie, he was a contestant on the $300 house many years ago. But his perseverance and his dedication has come through so that 10 years later, Hennie's in 26 countries. The World Economic Forum has called Hennie's model of housing the future of housing in the developing world. So Hennie, tell us a little bit about Moladi and how you came up with the idea and what it is and where you're going now and sort of what has COVID done to your business? Go ahead.
Thank you, Christian. Good evening, gentlemen. Or good morning, I'm not too sure. My background is, I'm a tradesman, I'm a tool and die maker. And when I do injection molding, I use a plastic raw material that cost me X amount per kilogram. And I shoot it into a mold and I have a cycle time that the mold cools and the mold opens and ejects a component. So I know what every component costs. If I look at construction and I look at producing bricks, and some of them break when you fire them, some break when you put them on a truck, and some break when you transport them, and some of them break when you offload them, and then you have somebody on a on a trestle that breaks it because he's got to put it into a little spot, then I just see an absolute waste. And I think, how do we optimize this? So I then... in 1986, I started off with Moladi and I made a mold which I cast the whole house in a day. So the beauty is that if I have a 2-liter Coke bottle, and in South Africa we pay 20 rand for it. So if I fill four glasses, then I know every glass cost me 5 rand. So now immediately I get to the point where I look at housing as a production line, very much like the automotive industry. So Henry Ford to me is one of my heroes. If I look at how disruptive Henry Ford was in the automotive industry, he made everybody sharpen up or they would have absolutely lost out. So when Mo spoke about, you know, the existing expensive health system in the US, then we could say that the housing in the world is also sick because it's very, very expensive. And no one really looks at how do we reinvent this, because it's quite nice to have in Africa a four million house backlog, because it means that I can go on pension with a 4 million house backlog. I don't have to worry about it. So just 2 days ago, I had a call with one of the political parties down in Cape Town, and I spoke to the lady and I said to her, this is what Moladi does. And she came back to me and she said to her, this is their policy. And for the first time, I realized that in a sense, where in her position, her solution is her policy. She does not see me wanting to change the way houses are built. She only focuses on policy. So in a sense, we like two ships in the night. We don't really make contact. So it's very difficult, I think, to really get across what I'm trying to achieve, because it's novel. It's to some people, it's I'm cuckoo. But for me, ultimately, if I look at the backlog, just in Africa, 4 million houses, if I read what happened to Katera in the US, where they thought that putting up a plant and producing houses and shipping them out was a solution. It's taken us 34 years of really getting to understand, and many visits. I've been to 64 countries, and all of this knowledge coming together puts new thoughts in your head. And the new thoughts is like Martin Luther King said, you don't need to see the whole staircase to take the first step. So one of the things that I've done with Moladi is I've really taken step, built a step. I have a goal and I've systematically built steps, and I didn't have all the steps. About 2 weeks ago, I came back from Ghana, and for the first time, I was able to put together the holistic Moladi plan that solved many, many issues. So now I feel I could write a letter to Bill Gates and tell him, please to move over, because there's more people wanting my windows than his windows. So what we've done is whenever you're in Africa, you have a problem raising capital because most of them are bankrupt. So even if they gave you an offtake agreement, or they gave you a bank guarantee or a sovereign guarantee, it would not be valid. In this case, they committed their Facebook database to us, their staff names. So they gave us 60,000 names of people that earn a salary every
month. Wait, that's against GDPR. Be careful, Henny. Okay, now keep going. Privacy, yeah.
Then what we then did is we focused on what their pay packet was. So in South Africa, if you want to buy a house, you cannot pay more than a third of your salary on a mortgage. So obviously in 2008, that's what the bankers forgot to stick to in America. So here we are now, where we look at people earning maybe $1,000, maybe $2,000. And the opportunity here is to see the viability of this as a potential customer, meaning that we could develop a product specifically for them. It could be a $5,000 house. It could be a $10,000 house. Now, if you look at Stuart and his diamond shape or his pyramid shape, Maslow said the basic fundamentals is food and shelter. So, and then also like Joe said earlier, you know, if you Maslow and you're a hammer, all the problems are a nail. So I also look at it in a sense like that, you know, I can solve all the problems with moladi. The advantage that we have here is I took those names and I went to Canada and I said, I have these potential customers and we're going to sell only on the first year, 6,000 houses. We're going to spread it over 10 years. And Ghana is a very stable country and we need to raise capital so that we can mortgage the homes to these people over 10, 15, 20 years. But the beauty about it is, as moladi, I'm not going to sell the house at profit. I'm selling it at cost. I can sell it below cost if I wish. Because if you look at the interest rate over the long term of 20 years, then all of a sudden that is more than anybody can make as a profit. So now that we have this opportunity, we put together villages. And every village needs a cell phone tower, needs electricity, needs water, needs champion. So my era still is Michael Schumacher standing on the podium and he pops champagne and the cameras on him. And in the background is his phenomenal vehicle, the Ferrari. And around the Ferrari are people that change tires in 6 seconds. So Michael Schumacher would never really stand on the podium if the car broke or if the people took a minute to change tires. So for moladi, what we've done is we said, we want to build teams in the pit. And let's say, for instance, Bob with his solar knowledge comes into the pit. Then we don't start from base anymore. We start from here. We simply apply. We plug in. And now we're moving to Pakistan. Pakistan, Imran Khan, Prime Minister, said that he needed 5 million houses in 3 years. So the opportunity for housing is absolutely phenomenal. So when I started out, I didn't understand what base of the pyramid meant till I came across Stuart and I read some of his articles. And that then gave me the idea of really, even in a sense, changing the curriculum where everybody thinks we have to go to university, get a degree in order to work at the top of the pyramid. But if you look at how many people are not producing at the base of the pyramid, we really have to get to a point where we make tables and chairs and windows and doors in order to stimulate the economy. And in South Africa, the most difficult thing is for me is to get this across to people that don't understand business. They're politicians, they talk, they don't understand. And the most frustrating thing is that we have 12 million people unemployed, we have 3 million house backlog. So I see the housing backlog as key to do development. And the simplicity that we apply by casting a house a day in a mold or 10,000 or 1,000 or 100 houses a day. So we form alliances with...
Hennie, I'm going to stop you for a second.
Sure.
I want people to know that your technology is basically these plastic molds that you form the skeleton of the house. You then get semi-skilled people who don't have to go to university, who you can hire and train all in the field, local people who can then work to build these houses by pouring the cement and concrete into the, and you've got a special concrete that you formulated, and that this house is then built in one day. You know, and then you take that mold and do it again and again, and you can use this mold 50 times at least. So this is something that was unheard of at the time when this first came out and sort of shocked the building world. But now, without the support, let's say, of the status quo building construction industry, Hennie has been able to expand this to 26 countries by just sheer perseverance and then finding ways to create solutions and even financing and mortgages, as you just heard, by connecting the investors in Canada and Ghana. So what I'm thinking is, we really need more entrepreneurship in a sense, and less, you know, I'm all for government intervention in certain cases, but what we've got to find is some way for government to become more enlightened, to actually create holistic solutions that include healthcare in the village that you build. So that, and really this is sort of a neighborhood-based, village-based regeneration strategy that has to happen. Go ahead, Stuart.
Christian, I think what makes, and Hennie and Bob, I think have really kind of given the texture of what, you know, this idea of, you know, sort of bottom up or green leap or base of the pyramid or reverse innovation or whatever, you know, piece of jargon we choose to attach to it, what the logic for it is, you know, which is to say you can bring innovations which would struggle if you try to, if you first try to bring them into commercial reality at the top of the income pyramid, at least in part, and maybe a big part of the reason why is because you're blocked by by regulation. You know, you're blocked by codes and regulations. So it's deliciously ironic, right? That it's the lack of those building codes and regulations at the base of the pyramid that enables you to take a leap. So it's deliciously ironic that way. And it's precisely rigid, old, you know, shop-worn, out-of-date rules, regulations, and building codes at the top that prevent this sort of leap from happening. You know, and you're able to bring technologies that really do leap, you know, that as Clay Christensen would say, is disruptive in a Christensenian sense, because as, you know, as Clay articulated, a disruptive innovation is one that makes functionality available to the less affluent and less sophisticated, people who were not able to avail themselves of a service before. And it would be seen by the more affluent, you know, high-end consumers as not being good enough. But initially it absolutely serves the needs of those who have been left out. That's the definition of a disruptive technology. And in this case, the further down the income pyramid you leap, the more room over time there is to migrate back up market, right? So the reverse innovation engine could be really powerful, and eventually maybe it makes its way back to the top of the pyramid.
Yeah, in fact, I've been sending Hennie Botes a bunch of fancy architectural buildings that are all made of concrete, which I keep thinking maybe he's going to make some of these molds and I can have a beautiful house somewhere, because the technique is the same, right? It's just the design of this house. Mo, you still there? Okay, before you leave, I have a question for you, Mo, in terms of what can be done, you know, in a concrete way. Where do we have to apply pressure to bring, you know, the American healthcare system back to some kind of, you know, commonsensical sort of thing? Because we've obviously run, you know, the ship into the rocks, and we're doing this with everything, right, Stuart? I mean, we're just doing, we're just running everything into the rocks. Yeah.
We'll be the last to change.
Yeah. And
I think it's.
Go ahead.
It's the same model and the same conversation we're having on the housing. So you have to innovate and build a system of care that's geared toward the, I will use the same terms, the bottom of the pyramid. I think the system was built to make money. The system was built to say, who can pay for the service? And I can charge an insane amount of money for surgery, even though it costs less. And so we have to go learn from India and other where they're able to do heart surgery for minimal cost at high quality. So we have to start with, you know, just like those moonshot project that says, can I deliver a house for $1,000 or $5,000? We have to, you know, we have to do a moonshot in healthcare and say, can I deliver high quality care for, you know, $100? And what does that mean from an education perspective? Because we have to retool it. Like right now, our biggest thing is shortage of talent. you know, we don't have enough nurses, we don't have enough doctors, we don't have a, and because we build a system that's an expensive system that says, well, you cannot work as a nurse unless you have a bachelor degree. While everywhere else in the world, you can have a 2 years degree, but with the right training and to be able to do that. So cost is, so I would, if I want to make a dent in healthcare, I have to innovate to serve and challenge ourselves and say, you can still deliver high quality at a lower cost, but you just can't use the same system to be able to do that. I mean, there was, you know, the famous article by Kotler that says, you know, the existing structure will try to kill innovation because it tried to protect itself. And so how do you create a parallel system that says, you know what, we're going to go here to the side, we're going to innovate without any of those constraints so that we can enable that. So, and there's model out there, but I think this is the opportunity to learn and import ideas from other country and not claim with the arrogance that we know it all in the U.S.
In fact, Mo, I was going to tell you, Bob, with the Solar Electric Light Fund, has been electrifying the clinics of Partners in Health in Haiti. So, oops, did we lose? I guess we lost him.
No, yeah, Mo's still here.
Mo's still there? Okay, I thought I lost him. So Bob, why don't you tell us a little bit about the, I mean, Partners in Health, I don't know if you know them, but they're a nonprofit. They've been doing healthcare in Haiti, and the outcomes that they have in Haiti are as better than the outcomes that they have in the Boston, sort of downtown Boston with the healthcare there. And the story of Paul Farmer, which, you know, I'd love to, I mean, we couldn't get a hold of him, but he's sort of the co-founder or founder of Partners in Health in Haiti and now in many African countries. Bob, why don't you tell us a little bit about what you did? And this is, again, an example of maybe this is where we need to learn how to create and learn from what's happening in Haiti, where they're having better outcomes in healthcare than in Haiti, right? I mean, just let me pause for a second and say that again. Bob, tell us the story.
Actually, our collaboration with Partners in Health, or PIH, as their acronym goes, began in Rwanda. For many years, they were just primarily focused in Haiti and then branched out. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, Rwanda was their first foray into Africa, and they had built a series of clinics in eastern Rwanda. And initially, their plan was to rely on diesel generators to power these facilities. And we went up and met with their executive leadership in Boston and said, you know, this is crazy. You're just going to be throwing money away. Let's design a solar solution. Actually, it turned out to be a solar hybrid solution. So it was primarily solar photovoltaics, but we did have diesel backup so that, because in a hospital environment, you can't afford any downtime. So our solution was primarily based on solar with diesel and of course battery storage and diesel as backup. And so we did first five clinics in Rwanda and then subsequently a series of clinics in very remote parts of Lesotho in Southern Africa. And then finally, we went to Haiti and electrified 10 of their facilities, mostly in the Central Plateau region of Haiti. The first one was at a place called Bukankare up in the Central Plateau. We did this before the earthquake of 2010. And of course, Port-au-Prince was a complete mess. And nobody could get diesel fuel to all the facilities. So it was a real problem just treating people. Fortunately, because PIH had put in solar at the Bukankare facility up in the Central Plateau, they were able to treat patients from day one. So that just shows you how resilient solar energy can be, even in the aftermath of an earthquake or a hurricane or some other natural disaster. People who have solar, especially if it got battery backups, don't have to be affected by these natural disasters. And, you know, more recently, under the auspices of the United Nations Foundation, we went and electrified 62 rural clinics in Ghana and Uganda. And clearly the World Health Organization and other entities are recognizing the value of bringing solar electricity to rural health clinics because, you know, basically without modern energy, there's no way that they can deliver the results that they need to. it cripples their efforts. And my hope is that, you know, that the pandemic, as painful as it has been, has hopefully driven home some very important lessons that we all need to learn. First, we're all connected, right? There is no us versus them. The virus doesn't know or respect boundaries. Neither does climate change. And, you know, if we're going to, you know, the nice thing about bringing solar electricity to rural clinics to, let's say, vaccinate people, once you've got the power in these clinics, you're going to be able to provide healthcare better to these populations. And that is a foundation for life. We don't have our health.
So, Hennie, you need to be building hospitals that are powered with Bob's stuff. And we've got some kind of solution right here, you know. And then we get partners in health to be the doctors in the place. So we've got one sort of solution that comes, you know. That I mean, what I'm trying to say really here is that just by talking to you guys, I see, you know, this integrated thing that could happen, right? That we've been pushing for a while. But here's some question from. I'll shut up for a second. Raymond, go ahead. What's your question?
Oh, I didn't mean to interrupt the question.
Go ahead.
As you know, the conversation was going on, I was just, a thought arose about the role of, you know, sort of like individual, or not necessarily individual, but like sort of small scale habit formation and sort of like preventative practices or measures. And like the role of sort of empowering, you know, individuals in smaller communities to have like this baseline level of self-care and livelihood, such that, you know, all the sort of ways that the system can be sort of plugged up and incur a lot of bloat, and, you know, become unsustainable, like that can be alleviated. For instance, in the healthcare industry, like basic education about nutrition and, you know, diet and exercise versus having a bunch of patients overloading the system where those resources could be otherwise routed towards people who are in like dire need of assistance. So like I was wondering if anyone could sort of talk to the role of individual or self-empowered action towards helping alleviate the inefficiencies in these large scale systems when it comes to health or housing or energy.
I think Hennie, you should answer that because you're like an individual who's basically been banging his head against the wall for the past 20 years and has persevered and some would say succeeded, even though I think you're just at the edge of that, right? Hennie, so go ahead, tell us a little bit about this individual journey.
I think that if you look at this forum, bringing Bob and myself together, if we look at government and we look at people, the people have most probably no contact whatsoever with government, and people have great expectations of government, like to fix sewage and potholes, and government doesn't have a cooking clue how to do these things. So what we said is, when we go to the community, we create cooperatives. So within the community, the community chooses cooperative leaders. So that's like the management team. And in this management team, when we start, let's say, the construction, we'll say, who would like to weld? And some people wouldn't even know what weld is. So we'll give them the steel, the jig, we'll give them the welding machine, we'll teach them how to weld the windows and the doors, and we will purchase that from them so that is circular economy. And the other thing is we get supplied components for our assembly line. So it's a win-win. Now we reduce the cost of the house. We have a mortgage system. The community earns money, which eventually makes them one of our customers. And that's very much like what Henry Ford wanted to do. So there are many people outside this cooperative that want to participate, but they don't know how. So once you create the forum, the cooperative, then somebody with knowledge on health can plug into the cooperative, and we'll ask the community who wants to be a nurse. So all of a sudden, the cooperative model becomes the link between, let's say, the knowledge base and the community. Because it's in order for us to duplicate, I'm sure if you ask Bob how long and how many hours and how much money he spent to get to those markets. And the same with us. But if we have created a common denominator, then we can reduce that proverbial cost of sale by getting to the community far quicker and teach them how to plant a tomato and an onion. You know, I don't know how to do that, but the people in the pit would understand how to do that. So the gentleman that was on early on said, how do we get this across? It is by promoting the knowledge base outside into the cooperative in order to assist the community, in order to teach the community new life skills. If you look at school and education, in South Africa, we go to grade 12. So after grade 12 is reached, you have your teacher. And then if you get good enough grades, then you go to university, you have a teacher. Then after that, you flung out there. No one teaches you how to do business. Nobody teaches you how to be an entrepreneur. Or for those people that didn't make the grade 12, that stopped at grade 10 or grade 8. So we've got to get an intermediate, and this intermediate for me is this cooperative model, where we can transfer those skills to the community, and the community can in reality help themselves.
Stuart, you have something to say. I can see that. Go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, I think what's being talked about here is really crucially important, which is that the only way to effectively create a sustainable and equitable form of development is to not just sell things commercially, right, to the underserved, but rather to co-create solutions with them in such a way that, you know, those that come in from the outside might bring expertise and technology and knowledge, and that can be transferred into the community in some ways, but that the community itself also brings knowledge to the table, such that they teach each other, but they also teach the experts who don't have a clue about the local conditions. So it's really a teacher learner, you know, all parties are both teachers and learners at the same time, as opposed to, you know, the wealthy PhD educated people coming in from the outside to solve all the problems.
Phil, what do you say? I think you've got something to say here.
Well, all I want to say is that this has been very edifying because it's full of good news and bad news. The good news about housing and its possibilities, the idea that if we could ever get a single payer system in the United States, we'll maybe catch up to Canada and so on. There are things happening with other things. For example, when we talk about the cost of our healthcare system, I'm always trying to get out word about what we call medical tourism. Why are you going to that hospital for the hip surgery when you can go to India or Thailand with your family and at lower cost have your operation and have a good vacation? So medical, there's always holes that you can punch into bad systems. But basically, I think that I'm always thinking of the US situation. Maybe help will come from specific cities. In, you know, we always think about the federal government coming in to solve the problem. But let's take Cincinnati, very progressive city. They're probably figuring out this health system's costing us too much in Cincinnati. And our housing problem is bad too. So how do we get smaller communities and units to work hard and express and be aware of solutions that are coming in this kind of discussion? And that's a marketing problem in part. And as a marketer, I got to figure out in listening to all of this, how can we, let's go even with the present COVID problem. How do we even get people to wear a mask and get vaccinated, and then solves the whole problem that we're having now. That's all it takes, but we can't do it. I was depressed because I've talked a lot about what we call social marketing and its techniques to use marketing to get people to change for the better, to do what's better for them. And it did not work yet for this COVID problem. And we're going to end up not solving it with marketing. We're going to solve it with mandatory behavior, namely passing laws requiring people. In other words, saying to people who are not inoculated, they cannot go to see a theater performance. They can't even work at their own company. I also want to add that companies are very important here. We have to recognize there are many CEOs now who are as upset as we are with the situation with medicine and housing and so on. And I have a little more hope than some other people may have in some leading CEOs starting to press for single payer system, starting to press for housing solutions. And maybe we have to go to them if we can't get it through government. Just some observations.
No, Phil, I think that's exactly right. You know, and it comes back to what I was saying earlier, that we've arrived at a point where an important role for corporate leadership is to be intimately involved in system redesign.
Exactly.
That's really important.
Yeah. Everyone was like the guy who ran Unilever. You would have immediately worked on answers like that.
Yeah.
That's Paul Polman. We need to get him in here. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
You know, maybe we can get him in here for a special discussion, because they have a book out with Andrew Winston, I believe, called Net Positive or something. I forget the name.
That's the title. Yeah. I've read the book and it's a great piece of work, and probably half of it is devoted to this idea of creating partnership ecosystems and system redesign.
And let's bring in A.G. Lafley, who lives in Sarasota, where I live. And he's a good guy, and he would, along with Paul Pullman and others, talk about these problems just the way you guys have talked about it.
Go get him. Go get him, Phil. Tell him he's on next. Go get A.G. Lafley. And tell him we have a new housing solution for the world, that it's not just for the developing world. It's for the, you know, America needs housing too. I mean, this is the tragedy, is that we really have the solutions. We just don't have the willpower or the, the organizational capability to address these problems, because we've siloed ourselves in ways that we cannot solve anything.
We've locked ourselves out, you know? I mean, like, to your point, Hennie, like, I've done a bunch of work with Cemex, you know, and that whole Patrimony OA initiative, you know, which is a do-it-yourself home builder in the slums business offering that makes it, you know, that offers up design options and warehouses materials and delivers them to the site and cuts the cost for do-it-yourself home builders, skills them up as well. And, you know, Cemex, you know, has always done business in the U.S., you know, just selling, you know, to commercial customers, but they were interested in entering, you know, at sort of the lower end. And initially it didn't really, the idea that they could bring something like the Patrimony OA model to the U.S. never really occurred to them, which is rather interesting. And it wasn't for lack of actually exploring a bit, but they just concluded that the U.S. market was so hamstrung in terms of construction and home building by building codes and regulations that it would be almost impossible to bring a model like that to the U.S., even though it could work really well, right? I mean, this sort of Habitat for Humanity. But what if you brought a combination of moladi, you know, and Patrimony OA to the U.S.? That could make a huge difference. But every step of the way, you're blocked by regulation and building code. I'm not an anti-government guy, by the way. You know, I'm just saying that we need to be clearer about, you know, where does government play a positive role, and where, in some cases, does it really block innovation?
Well, we need institutional innovation, because that's part of the problem, is that our institutions have stayed behind. They're still in the 40s or 50s.
Yeah, exactly.
And the world's moved on. So we've got to bring them
got a bunch of antiquated old regulations, you know, which kind of lock us into the way things were done 40 years ago and shut us out of the innovations that are occurring coming from the bottom up.
Phil, you're going to say something?
Well, I was just going to say that I welcomed the point that Stuart said about colleges being our problem, namely the MBA programs, because I taught in them. You have, Stuart, and others. And it is true that Milton Friedman was being featured as the hero. Freedom and Milton once said at one point that any tax is too much. There should be no taxes. I don't know how he got away with that. And the point is, Stuart, are you seeing some colleges, some MBA programs that are really changing to what they should be teaching the students?
Well, you know, thank you, Phil, for that question.
I hope one of the big ones, whether it's Stanford or Harvard or some, would start pushing that.
But you know, when you think about it, right, if you think about this as yet another example of disruptive innovation, in some ways, the big incumbents will be the last to change, right? They'll take on protective acceleration, and they already are. They have been, right? I spent the first 25, 30 years of my career at Michigan, North Carolina, Cornell, you know, starting centers focused on sustainable business, and it's all good work, right? But at the end of the day, it's still, the metaphor we use is it's a saddlebag hanging off the side of the horse, right?
It's an add-on.
Yeah, it's like it hangs off the side. The horse is the core curriculum. And the horse hasn't changed in 40 years, right? It still hasn't changed. It's still the same core curriculum.
We added a course in ethics to put on the saddle.
It's a saddlebag.
And a few others, yeah. Social responsibility got in there. Yeah.
Saddlebag. I've been involved, you know, I think, as you know, in creating this new MBA program at the University of Vermont called the Sustainable Innovation MBA program.
That's right.
Yep. We're now on our seventh cohort, right? I don't want to speak prematurely, but I think we could say that this has passed the test, you know, that it actually is standing on 2 feet now. And it's a clean sheet redesign of the MBA. In other words, we didn't just accept the old core with all the assumptions and ideologies around shareholder primacy and so forth. We'd rejected all that, started with a clean sheet of paper and built a new MBA program from scratch. It's called the Sustainable Innovation MBA. And I think it represents a model, not the model, but a model of what business education needs to look like, you know, in the 21st century. And part of our mission is to not just, you know, have this program be successful by itself, but to work with other schools that are interested in creatively destroying their own MBA. I mean, the truth is that a lot of second tier schools now are shutting down their MBA programs, right? Because applications are decreasing, not increasing, even at the tier one MBA programs. So, but second tier schools are in big trouble and they know it, right? So deans are increasingly open. So I think the dynamic of this, Phil, will be much as, you know, it'll be disruptive innovation, you know, in the educational sector where the innovation will occur first is in the second tier, and it'll move up market over time, and the big incumbents will be the last to change.
Yeah. Well, good luck with Vermont. That sounds great.
Yeah, and I can vouch for everything that Stu has just talked to, because I was honored to be an advisor and got to go up to University of Vermont and witness firsthand the incredible things going on there with the students and their courses. It was game changing and just a real breath of fresh air. So that too, you could say, was one guy.
See, that's the power of the individual, Stuart Hart and Sanjay Sharma, who worked to make this happen. You know, that, you know, they worked on this for many years at other schools and then finally got a chance to do it. Hennie,
Sanjay Sharma is the dean, you know, and so without dean support, nothing like this ever happens.
Hennie?
I refer many times to just two examples that I see as development stumbling blocks. Henry Ford with his Model T goes to Mr. Horse and Carriage in New York and says to them, you know, when you take your people from New York, let's say to Texas, you stop over in A and B and C and D, and A, you change the horses, and The guys can have a shower or a bath and a whiskey and you know, and all the things they go with in the hotel. And I don't believe that Henry Ford ever sold a Model T to the horse and carriage industry, because they were so set in their ways. This is how they made money. So eventually, if you look today out your window and see how many horse and carriages you have versus how many Model Ts, so that is creative destruction. So many times we have to fight hard to eventually kill the old in order to go forward. The other one was, there was a lovely program about the Apple Mac. The Apple Mac, Christian, I'll send you the little clip. It says the Apple Mac really stayed a nerd computer. Yes. But when they took the computer and they gave it to the public, that is when Apple Mac exploded. So many times when we develop product, I think we have to understand that we have to take it away from, let's say, the MBA or the nerd or the top of the pyramid, and really give it to the base of the pyramid in order for it to explode.
Good point. Well, guys, I think we're out of time, but I just want to thank everyone for a beautiful show. This was really a lot of fun. And some of my favorite people are here, and I just want to say thank you all for making it.
I've known you all
for so many years. So in a way, this is actually a really sweet moment for me to see you all together.
Thanks, guys. Really good to see everyone. Thank you, Christian.
Thanks.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Christian. And nice to see you, Stu, and to meet
likewise,
see you again.
Likewise.
Nice to
good
meet
to
you.
See everyone.
Good luck on all your adventures and so on. Boy, that housing thing. Get it going. Show us a demo right in the city of Chicago.
I don't know whether I should say, but we are actually getting everything ready to start our first show house in Idaho.
Wonderful.
There you go.
Wonderful. Yeah, thank you. We're very chuffed about that.
Let us know what happens.
Yeah, one of the few states that would declare that they would, you know, probably get rid of any regulations that might that would block you from doing.
Yes, ironically. Here we shouldn't favor them, but we should.
Thank you very much, Christian. And you're a star. Thank you so much for putting this together. It's really phenomenal.
Christian. Yeah.
Thank you, Christian.
Okay. Ciao.